Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to quickly show how to create an effect something like this. So we've got a sort of ocean going on, and then we've got all these glittery objects moving around in it, and they're actually moving in accordance with the angle of the surface of this ocean. So you can see it gives quite an interesting effect, especially with some coloured lights around it. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. Feel free to comment or ask questions or even dislike the video. And if you don't like the video, I'd be very interested to see what the issues you spotted were so that I can improve going forward. If you're a Patreon supporter, I do upload these files for any use available to my Patreon supporters, and I upload tutorials quite regularly. So let's start the tutorial. So to begin with, we're just going to add a simple plane. We don't need to do anything else to that plane at the moment, but we're going to come over to modifier properties. We're going to add a modifier, and we're going to add the ocean modifier. And you can already see we've got something that's starting to look a bit like the surface of an ocean or sea. And if I play the animation, you can see nothing changes. And the reason for that is we need to do something with some properties over here. And the first one is time. As I change the value under time, you can see the surface starts undulating. So what we need to do is to animate this parameter. So I'm going to stick with 250 frames for this demonstration, and we'll start with the time at 1. And then I'm just going to press I, hovering over it, and you can see we get a little indicator of a keyframe there. And then I'll go to the end of the animation, and we'll set this to about 3 to see what that looks like, and press I there. If I now start the animation, you can see we've got a fairly slow change. And what I will do is I'm just going to right click the keyframe there and set the interpolation mode to linear, so it's the same speed across the entire animation. I want to go with fairly slow because some of the effects we're going to get later will be very fast, even with a relatively slow motion. Then we want to play with a few other parameters, so I'm going to set the render quality up to 14, and I'm going to set the viewport to 14 as well. So this just increases the resolution. You can see we've got finer detail on there now. And if we come down to waves, we can play with the scale a little bit, so I can make it a bit more extreme. I went with about 2.5, I think. The rest I pretty much left as defaults. So you can see we've got this turbulent ocean going on here now. You may want it to be quite a bit bigger than that, and there's an easy way to do that without just rescaling and what have you. You can just add repeats here. You can see there that's repeated the X, but they join together, so it's not very noticeable that they're being repeated, and then repeat the Y as well. Now we've got one that's double the size. For our purposes, I'm going to go back to just 1 because it does add a lot more geometry and slows things down. You can see we're only managing around 9 frames a second at the moment, so I'm just going to drop that back and we're back up at 25 frames a second. So that's our animated ocean. I'm going to open a new window here. I didn't actually render this ocean object at all, but we'll just call that ocean. And see, I've opened another window there, but I'll use that in a moment. I'm just going to add an object now, and it's going to be a cube initially. And the idea of this is just to have some facets. So if I do Control B there, I can now just add some additional geometry there. Go to face select, press I, and I can bring that in. GZ just to pull it up a little bit. Scale it in, perhaps up a little further. As I say, all I'm really doing is just creating some additional faces for this whole thing, just to help it twinkle. So that object will do fine. I don't want too much geometry on it anyway. So we'll just call this object. We'll give that a simple material for the moment. I'll make them a golden color, and we'll turn metallic all the way up and roughness most of the way down. Just to make it easy to see, we'll color it in the viewport display as well. So that's our object. You can see the origin is down there in the middle, and that's fine. So we'll come back to our ocean now. So I'm going to change this top window to the geometry node editor, and I'm going to say new, which will add a geometry node modifier. And obviously we just get our default there. If I break that, you can see the ocean seems to disappear. It's still there. The geometry is all still there, but we can't see it if that's broken, which it will be when we add another node. So the first thing I'm going to add, if I press F3, is an instance on points node, and I'll just drop that in there, and you can see our geometry disappeared. And I'm also now going to come over to here, select my object, and just drag that into this window. So we've now got a node which relates to that object we created, this one down here, and I'm going to take the geometry out of that one into the instance on that instance on points. And then all of a sudden you can see we actually have lots and lots of copies of that object. They're quite large at the moment. We can obviously turn the scale down here. So I set that to 0.1 and you can see there it is. There is our object. I go slightly smaller again and I'm going to turn grids and things off so that we can see things a little better. So you can see we've already got our ocean with these objects on it. And that may be what you want or it may not. But you can see all they're doing at the moment is just moving up and down and back and forth slightly with the surface of the ocean. I wanted them to change shape and size slightly depending on what was going on that surface. So I'm also going to add an edge angle node, which detects, as it says, the edge of the angle of the geometry associated with the point. So if I just drag that unsigned angle, so we've got a signed angle and an unsigned angle. The signed angle means it can go from positive to negative, and the unsigned means it's just naught to a value. So if I just take the unsigned into scale, for example, now you can see how the scale of our objects is changing. And it's not just based, in fact, it's not at all based on the height of geometry, although I could do that if you wanted to. This is based on the angle of that particular bit of geometry. And bear in mind, we've got some fine details in the surface of this ocean, which is what's giving us this variation. So that's the unsigned one. And if I take that one out and put the signed one in, now you can see we've got some that are inverted, effectively a negative scale, which is why they're pointing the other way. And then sometimes suddenly flipping over as the angle goes past the point that it's going to be negative. And we can do the same thing with rotation. If I just take that into there, you can now see we've got a little bit of rotation going on these objects, but we'll need to scale it a bit. So I'm going to use the signed angle and I'm going to add under utilities a math node, or maths as we call it in the UK, and I'll drop that in there. It's currently set to add. I'm going to change it to multiply and I'm going to put a value of 2 on there. So now it's a more extreme angle. But I also wanted to control which of the axes, in this case for rotation, were affected. So I'm going to add under vector a combine XYZ node and drop that in there. And I'm going to take the value from that multiply into both X and Y. So that's basically affecting the rotation for two of the axes. Now I'm going to add another multiply node, take the same value into that. I'm going to set this one much higher. I'm going to set it to 25 and then take that into Z. And you can see the Z sort of controls the vertical rotation on my object, and the other two, the sort of left and right motion. And I think maybe I'll go even smaller on the other two. We're getting some rotation in each of the axes, but most of the rotation is taking place. You can see some of them are sort of swirling around. And then I need to do something similar for scale, except scale is more straightforward. I don't want to distort the shapes in this particular case. I just want to scale it overall on the size. So I don't need to split the axes down in any way, but I do want to control the individual scale. So again, we'll take out a multiply node, drop that into there, and I'm going to create another math node, and we'll change that one to add, and we'll drop that in there. So I'm going to set the scale to 0.25 as a starting point, and I'm going to add 0.075. So the reason that I've done that is basically it means if the incoming value is 0, then obviously this multiply node isn't going to do anything. It's still going to be 0. But this add node will mean that the minimum scale will always be 0.075. It'll always be visible. It won't disappear completely. And you might want it to disappear, in which case you wouldn't use that add node. Say it's just setting the minimum scale. So I'm now just going to take that into the scale input. And now you can see we've got variation in scale as well as rotation. So we'll have a good look at that. And that gives you some quite interesting effects. So that's all of the modeling, all of the geometry node setup. I'm not going to do a big complicated geometry node setup, but I'll open that up now so that you can have a good look at that. So once again, we're just putting an instance on points into our geometry node. We're creating an object which we're dragging into the geometry nodes and then feeding into the instance. So that's what gets instanced. We're using the edge angle, so we're detecting the angle of each face within the object where each point is. We're scaling it with these multiply nodes. So, and Z, I'm scaling up at a much larger value. I happen to be using the signed version. You could be using the unsigned one if you prefer. Those are getting combined in a combine XYZ. So that's just done so I can scale Z separately from X and Y. And then that goes into rotation. I'm scaling the scale here. And then I'm adding a small value just to make sure that it has a minimum scale. It doesn't go down to zero. And that's it for the geometry nodes. So we need to put a few lights in the scene. We'll set the background to black. And the first thing I'm going to do is add a simple area light, quite a large lamp, something like that. The thing with fairly reflective objects is literally you need something to be reflected. I'm doing this in cycles. If you do this in EV, you may need to play around with the lights quite a bit more because there's some complications, but it can still be done in EV. So we'll just go to rendered view now and see what we've got. And you can see we can't see anything at the moment, or barely. There's just a hint of something there because the light is too dim. So let's try 1000 watts, and you can see we just about make it out now. It's not bright, and that's fine. I don't want it too bright, but we can zoom in there. So now I want to add some additional lights. So I'm going to add simple point light, and we'll lift that up. We'll go back into rendered view so we can see what's going on. And maybe we'll make this one a bright red light, and we'll try 100 watts. And you can play with the radius to adjust the size of the specular reflections. I'm going to go down a little bit on that. Let's go for 0.1, and maybe we'll go for 1000 watts again. You can see we're getting some red reflections being picked up there. So I'm going to put a few more out and give them different colors each. I'm being fairly arbitrary on my color selection. So let's have a look at that. And I think the area light can probably even be a little dimmer, and maybe turn the point lights up to 2000. We'll go for 2500, I think. And then the last thing I did for lighting was duplicated this light, scaled it down a little bit, rotate on the X 180, and then drop it down to be below this area. And I'm going to shrink that light a little bit as well. It's really just adding more things. You could use HDRIs, of course, that kind of thing. So we'll give that a quick render. And there's the basic render. Probably need to turn the lights up a little bit. But one of the things I then did was, if we go to the compositor and say use nodes, there's our output, there's our scene. I'm going to add, under filters, a glare node and drop that in there. I set mine to fog glow, left it on medium. In fact, used all the default settings, and you can see we've got now these little bright spots. And as it animates, those will flash because they're very flat surfaces. So they'll only meet the threshold pretty much exactly as the light reflects straight into the camera. But if it's too much, you can always turn the threshold down a little bit there. The only other thing I would remind you to do when doing a render, you only need RGB, you don't need RGBA. Obviously you need to set your file name and things like that. But come down to light paths, turn off reflective and refractive caustics. You really don't need those for a scene like this. And I use denoise as well. I tried the optics denoiser, but I found for this scene, the open image denoise was fine. And you can play around with things like contrast and what have you as well, if you want to. So under render properties, if you go to color management, you can play around with things like the gamma, just to increase the contrast a little bit. Generally filmic or filmic log is the sort of output you want to use, but maybe a bit extreme in this case. I turn the gamma down, you can see it's sort of not quite what we're looking for, but generally filmic, which is the default, is what you want to use. And obviously you can play with the exposure as well. So I hope you enjoyed that short tutorial. If you did, let me know, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.